Hello students, welcome to my channel again. In the previous lecture we have discussed about wave mechanical treatment and we have derived Schrödinger equation, both time independent and time dependent Schrödinger equation in a very intuitive manner. And now today we will continue our previous lecture. And before going to the application of the Schrödinger equation, time independent Schrödinger equation actually, we will discuss about what is the limitations of the Schrödinger equation. So there are certain assumptions that we made during the derivation of the Schrödinger equation, and whatever assumption that we usually make while deriving any expression, it will obviously become its limitation. So for example, during the derivation of the Schrödinger equation, we made an assumption that the particle is moving with the speed which is very small as compared to the speed of light, or the particle is moving non-relativistically. So this becomes actually biggest limitation of the Schrödinger equation. So the first limitation of the Schrödinger equation that we can write is that it is this Schrödinger equation, it is applicable only for non-relativistic problems. Why? Because during its derivation we made the assumption that the particle is moving with small speed, low speed, speed which is comparable, which is very small as compared to the speed of light. Now what is the second limitation of the Schrödinger equation? So we know that Schrödinger equation is a differential equation, and if the number of particles in a system are very large, then for each particle there will be three position coordinates. That is, suppose for the first particle the position coordinates are x1, y1, z1. For second particle, let the position coordinates are x2, y2, z2, and so on at a given instant of time. So for each particle there will be three position coordinates. And if there are n particles, obviously there will be 3n position coordinates. So similarly, there will be different values of the components of the velocity or momentum of each particle at a given instant of time. So in the Schrödinger equation for a single particle, which we wrote it like this, del square psi plus 2m upon h cross square e minus u and psi is equal to 0. This is actually for time independent Schrödinger equation. We have to write this equation for many particle problem for each individual particle. Let us say for first particle, this equation would become del 1 square psi 1 2m e1 minus u1 and psi 1. Let us say this particle has mass m1, and similarly for second particle. Kindly remember I have written here del 1 because we know that del is equal to, del vector is equal to I cap curly upon curly x plus j cap curly upon curly y plus k cap curly upon curly z. Now for each individual particle, the value of x, y, z is different. Therefore, for first particle, del vector would become del 1, which should be curly upon curly x1, curly upon curly y1, curly upon curly z1. And for second particle, it should be curly upon curly x2, curly upon curly y2, and curly upon curly z2. Therefore, for a system of particle, we must write this kind of equation for each particle individually, and then all these equations have to be solved simultaneously to obtain the overall wave function of the system. That So only this kind of a concept will be able to give you some an idea that it is a very complex equation to solve for a multi-particle, many particle problems. So therefore, this becomes very important limitation of the Schrödinger equation, that for large number of complex systems, for many particle systems, this Schrödinger equation is almost very difficult to solve. So for doing the problems of many particles using Schrödinger equation, we have to use very powerful supercomputers, and we have to resort to some other techniques also, which are called approximation techniques and perturbation theory, that came into existence only because of the fact that Schrödinger equation is actually exactly solvable for very simple problems, and it is not exactly solvable for complex problems. So that we have to take into account. So this is the second limitation of the Schrödinger equation, that for a complex problem it is not easy to solve. And third problem is that, which is actually the consequence of the second, that we need to have the solution of Schrödinger equation. For solving Schrödinger equation, we need to have high performance computational tools. We need very powerful computers for solving the Schrödinger equation related with the complex system. The next limitation of the Schrödinger equation is that it sometimes, when it is solved, sometimes the solution obtained may not be many. It gives many solutions. Sometimes it is difficult to solve, and when it is solved, the Schrödinger equation will give us many solutions, out of which large number of solutions are meaningless. So Schrödinger equation, because it is a differential equation, and we know that in case of differential equations, for a given differential equation, we can have large number of solutions. So these different solutions are called particular solutions, and we can obtain a general solution by obtaining the superpositions of large number of particular solutions. So, or vice versa, we can convert a general solution into a particular solution by imposing certain conditions. But a number of solutions of the Schrödinger equation may not be meaningful at all. Next limitation, which is important for us, is that we know in quantum mechanics we obtain four quantum numbers. One is called n, principal quantum number, l, m and s, orbital quantum number, magnetic quantum number and the spin quantum number. Out of these four quantum numbers, these three quantum numbers directly appear while solving the Schrödinger equation of different complex problems, while this spin quantum number is not naturally obtained during the solution of the Schrödinger equation. This is the limitation of the Schrödinger equation. Schrödinger equation does not tell us about the four quantum numbers. It tells us only about three quantum numbers. The spin quantum number is something which we have to impose on the system, so that the experimental part or experimental observations may be in agreement with the theoretical. So that the theoretical calculations may be in agreement with the experimental observations. For example, if we just think about this Zeeman effect, so we cannot understand Zeeman effect without the knowledge of spin. and Schrodinger equation is clueless about the spin. So this fourth quantum number is actually imposed on the Schrodinger equation, imposed on the problems that we have to deal with at quantum level. So these were the basic limitations of the Schrodinger equation. Now we will discuss an important application of Schrodinger equation, that is called particle in a one-dimensional box. So today we will discuss that problem only. Thereafter we will stop. So particle in one dimensional box. This is an application of the time independent Schrodinger equation. So suppose our universe is only one dimensional. Let us say this is plus infinity and this is minus infinity. And suppose this is origin, and suppose this is some point P, and the distance between O and P is L. Since I have assumed that universe is only one dimensional, I will assume that this is x-axis. So the value of x is 0 here and the value of x is L here. And suppose there is a particle whose mass is m. This particle can move only toward left side or right side, and it cannot cross these boundaries O and P. Means it cannot come out of to the left of O and it cannot go to the right of P. So such a particle which can move only in one dimension and it is confined in two well-defined limits is called particle in a one-dimensional box. So this point O, therefore, since the particle is not able to come to the left of O, therefore the point O is a perfectly rigid point. Perfectly rigid point. Similarly, the particle is unable to pierce through point P. It cannot go to the right of P. Therefore, point P is also perfectly rigid. So, we know that every system tends to occupy the state of minimum potential energy. So, since particle is unable to reach in the region extending from O to minus infinity and P to plus infinity, therefore, in quantum mechanical way, we can say that perfectly rigid point or perfectly rigid region must have infinite potential energy, and infinite potential energy gives an unstability to the particle and particle will never go in that region. So to the left of O and to the right of P, potential energy is infinity because O and P are perfectly rigid points, and no object ever tries to go to the region having infinite potential energy because that will make it unstable. So in order to get stability, the object will always remain confined between O and P. Now this, kindly remember, whatever I have drawn on this board so far, it is a, let us say, it is a figure. So it describes my system. Now, in order to have a correlation, I would like to draw a graph. So please remember there is a difference between a figure and a graph. So just to have a correlation, one-to-one correlation, I would draw graph long-sided. And the graph, in case of graph, the variable along x-axis is the position, that is x. So this point is O and this point is P. Obviously here x is equal to 0, here is x is equal to L. And along y-axis I take psi. Since it is a graph, so this graph is variation of psi with respect to x along the whole universe, that is from minus infinity to plus infinity. So we know that square of the magnitude of the wave function represents probability of finding the particle. Since particle cannot exist to the left of O, therefore to the left of O, psi magnitude square, which is the probability of finding the particle, must be zero. If psi magnitude square is zero, this means psi itself should be zero. It's both real and imaginary parts. If it is a complex wave function, both have to be zero. That eventually means psi has to be zero. If psi has to be zero, it means the graph of psi from minus infinity up to O should be x-axis itself. Similarly, since particle cannot exist in the region extending from P to plus infinity, so we must have psi magnitude square equal to 0 or psi equal to 0. This means that the graph of psi versus x should again match with the x-axis from P to infinity. Now, since the particle can exist between O to P, therefore the graph between psi and x cannot be zero, cannot match with x-axis in general. So it could have any shape. Let us say it is of the graph, let us say between, let us say psi varies, suppose psi varies with respect to x like this. However, we cannot bet on the shape of the graph between psi and x in between O and P. But of course, we can always bet on the value of psi at O and at P. We know that the wave function has to be, wave function square is probability. So if I am coming from minus infinity toward O, this point is matching with x-axis, that means psi is 0. On the other hand, if I approach O from right hand side, and let us say the wave function has this kind of graph, and let us say it touches here, then I will be getting something absurd. From the right hand side, the value of psi at O should be this, because particle is existing. From the left hand side, the value of psi at O should be 0. That is not possible. At one point you cannot have two different values of psi, because psi magnitude square is probability, and if at one point there are two values of psi, it means the probability of finding the particle is not well defined. That is not true. So we must have unique value of probability at any point. So therefore, whatever is the shape of graph between O and P, we cannot bet on this. But we have must impose for the existence of the system that the graph between psi and x must pass through point O, so that this psi is 0 at O, whether we approach O from left hand side or from right hand side, and at one value and at O there is only one value of psi, that is 0. Similarly, we can understand that this graph must match with 0 at P. So therefore, before solving the problem, I have two conditions in my hand. What are those two conditions? These two conditions are called boundary conditions. The first condition is that when for x is equal to 0, we must have psi is equal to 0. Similarly, for x is equal to L, we must have psi is equal to 0. These two conditions are called boundary conditions, and it will be my starting point of the problem. So, next, I will assume that since the potential energy is infinity to the left, to the right of, to the left of O and to the right of P, in between, the particle is not interacting with anything. So, I can assume that between O and P, the potential energy of the object is 0. This is an assumption from my side. You can assume that potential energy has any constant value, but this value will not change between O and P because it is not interacting with anything else. So, I have taken the reference of potential energy at along this line to be 0. So, potential energy within the box is 0. It is an assumption from my side. You can assume it to be any constant, let us say. But it cannot be a variable, please remember. And 0 is also a constant. It is a typical constant. So, this is my next assumption. If I assume this, it means the total energy of the particle within the box is always equal to the kinetic energy, because I have assumed its potential energy to be 0. Now, let us go to the next part. So, one-dimensional time-independent Schrödinger equation is given by, that is d2 psi upon dx2 plus 2m upon h cross square e minus u and psi is equal to 0. This is the one-dimensional time-independent Schrödinger equation. But we have assumed that within the box, potential energy is 0. This is my assumption. Therefore, I will use this value of u, that is 0, here, and my Schrödinger equation will become d2 psi upon dx2 plus 2m e upon h cross square and psi is equal to 0. So, this will be my equation number 2. Now, suppose we assume that this quantity 2me upon h cross square is equal to a new variable k square. This is equation number 3. So, if I assume this, then equation number 2 would become d2 psi upon dx2 plus k square psi is equal to 0. This is equation number 4. Now, this equation is actually analogous to the equation of simple harmonic motion. Let me describe it to you. I do not need this diagram or this graph right now. I assume that you will keep it in mind. I would refer to it later on, but because of the shortage of space, I am going to erase it. Okay, what is simple harmonic motion? We know that the acceleration in simple harmonic motion is given by minus A is equal to minus omega square y, or you can say A plus omega square y equals to 0, but A is given by d2y by dt square plus omega square y equals to 0. Now, this is the equation of simple harmonic motion and this is the Schrodinger equation. Now, you can see both of these appear to be analogous. Here, in case of SHM, y is the displacement. Its role is being played by wave function here. T is time, whose role is being played by x here. Omega is angular frequency, whose role is played by k here. And the solution of this equation, it is a well-known equation of, let us say, higher secondary classes. So its solution we have already discussed in lower classes. The solution of this equation is given by A sin omega t plus B cos omega t. I hope all of you have studied this solution. So, if I want to draw analogy between these two equations, I can simply say that the solution of 4, according to this, its solution of 4 is of the form psi equals A sine, instead of omega I will get k, and instead of t I will get x, plus b cos omega kx. This is the solution. Here a and b are constants of integration, because the Schrodinger equation, that is equation number 4, is a second order linear differential equation. Therefore, its solution should have two constants of integration. Here A and B are these two constants of integration, and we want to find these two constants. In order to find these two constants, we will apply the boundary conditions that are given in equation number 1. So what is the first boundary condition? That for x is equal to 0, we must have psi equal to 0. If I apply this boundary condition on 5, then my 5 equation will give 0 equals A sin 0 plus B cos 0. That is equal to 0 plus B into 1. Therefore, B is equal to 0. So, out of the two constants, I have found the value of one constant, that is B. B, I have found it to be 0. So, put this value of B in 5. Therefore, my refined wave function is psi is equal to A sin kx. This is the refined wave function. Now, in order to find the second constant, that is A, you have to put the value of the second wave boundary condition. So, what is that? For x is equal to L, psi must be 0. Now, if I put this value here in equation 6, then I will get 0 is equal to A sin kn. So, of course, I was expecting that by putting the second boundary condition, I will get the value of A. However, it did not happen to be so. Why? Because now this 0 is equal to product of two quantities. It will mathematically it gives me two possibilities. What are those? It is either A is equal to 0 or sin KL is equal to 0. These are two mathematically possible solutions of equation number 7. Now, if A is equal to 0, this is mathematically possible, but it is not, it is a non-logical solution. I have already discussed that sometimes the solutions of Schrodinger equation becomes meaningless, and we have to identify those meaningless solutions, and we have to just take out these meaningless solutions. So A is equal to 0 is a mathematically possible solution, but it is not a logically acceptable solution for the system. Why? I will tell you the reason. Because we have already got the value of B. What is that? It is 0. If I accept that A is also 0, then the total wave function psi will be 0 inside the box. We have already made an assertion that particle cannot go to the left of psi O and to the right of P. Therefore, psi is 0 outside already. So, if psi is 0 inside the box, psi is 0 outside the box, therefore psi magnitude square will be 0 everywhere, which means that particle is not present in the universe. That is not the case, because particle is present, and this is actually given to us that particle is present between O and P. That is, it is always available within the box. So this is not a logical solution. So A is equal to 0 is not acceptable. So obviously we have to turn our attention toward the second possibility. So this is sine k l is equal to 0. Now we know that whenever in trigonometry, if sine theta is equal to 0, then theta is k l is equal to 0 gives me k l is equal to n pi. Equation number 8. Equation number 8 is called quantum condition. It is also called stability condition. Kindly remember that I have formulated the problem and I have made an assertion that a particle cannot move in any other dimension except x-axis. It can move only from x equal to 0 to x is equal to l. These are my assumptions. But we cannot make assumptions, we cannot make assertions in an ad hoc manner. Whenever we make some assumption or assertion, we must have some, let us say, base for that. We must have certain conditions. For example, I can say, let us say, I will make a building of this shape. That is my assertion, and that design is obviously available in lot of buildings. Then if we turn our attention to pyramids of Egypt, these are also available. Now on the other hand, if I make an assertion that I am going to make a system, or I am going to make a building whose shape is like this. It is an inverter pyramid. This is the surface of Earth. Now this is my assertion, this is my wish that I must make a building like this. However, in order to make a building like this, we have to provide conditions which are very difficult as compared to the conditions we must provide to make a structure like this. So therefore, this for the conditions under which this system is stable, the same conditions cannot make this system stable. Similarly, I have proposed that there is a particle which can travel only between O to P, and it can go to the left or right. This is my assertion. And if I am imposing these assertions on the system, that you do not go to the right of P, you do not go to the left of O, then there must be certain conditions which must be satisfied so that these two, the system remains stable under my wishes, for my wish, for my wished structure must be stable, and that and that is obtained here, that a particle can be confined in one dimensional box only and only if KL is integral multiple of pi. This is therefore the stability condition Only if this condition is satisfied, then such kind of system can be obtained. Quantum mechanically, such kind of system is possible. Now, why it is called quantum condition? Because this n is integer and it is called principal quantum number. It is the first quantum number that is obtained in the quantum mechanics. Due to that reason, it is also called quantum condition. It says that KL is quantized. And what is quanta? KL, the quanta for KL is pi. Means KL must always be integral multiple of pi. Now, what according to, again, I have already discussed with you that Schrödinger equation, when it is solved, we always get a large number of meaningless solutions. We have to identify the meaningless solutions and there we have to throw out these meaningless solutions which do not suit the system, because meaningless solutions are mathematically possible, but these may not be applicable to our problem. For example, if theta is equal to sine theta, in mathematics we say if sine theta is equal to 0, then theta is equal to n pi, where n can be 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and so on. If I just go on these guidelines here in equation of 8, I may make, by mistake, make an assertion that n is 0 or plus minus 1 or plus minus 2 or plus minus 3 and so on. Now, this is a mathematical possibility. Now, it is giving infinitely many values, possible values. Out of these, I have to carefully identify the meaningless values and I must reject them. First of all, let us stick our attention to n is equal to 0. What will happen if n is equal to 0? If n is equal to 0, that will make KL equal to 0. Now, our solution, it is given in equation 6. Initially, it was given in equation 5. Now, this is refined in equation 6. So, since B is 0, therefore, the refined solution is A sine kx is equal to 0. So, what is going to happen if I assume that n is equal to 0 is acceptable? Now, what is the problem with n is equal to 0? If I take n is equal to 0 as a possibility, now A is equal to 0 now is not acceptable. Suppose A is not 0, means I have rejected this solution. A is equal to 0 is rejected. It means A is not 0. But I reject it, but I accept it. I assume that A is not 0, but N is 0. Now, what was psi? Psi was equal to A sine kx. And if I see equation number 8, it will become A sine k is actually N pi by L and x. So, A is not 0, but N is 0. That will become A sine 0. This will give me psi is equal to 0. Again, that will bring me to the same problem which was there if I accept A equal to 0. Psi cannot be 0 inside. So, therefore, N is equal to 0 is a mathematical possibility, but it is not logically acceptable solution. So, therefore, although in mathematics we say sine theta is equal to 0, theta is equal to n pi, where n is equal to 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2 and so on. But here for this problem, I cannot say n is equal to 0. So n is equal to 0 is not acceptable possibility. Now let us take our attention toward n is equal to minus 1. Can we have n is equal to minus 1? The answer to this is again obviously no, because if n is equal to minus 1, we will have kl is equal to minus pi. Now k, as we will see later on in this article, it will be wave number which is equal to 2 pi by lambda. So the wavelength of any wave is always positive quantity. And length of the box, L is the length of the box. It is the span from O to P. It is also positive. And the product of two positive numbers can never be a negative number. So therefore, N is equal to minus 1 is not logically acceptable, although it is a mathematical possibility. Similarly, n is equal to minus 2, minus 3, or in general, not even a single negative value of n is acceptable. So I am therefore left with only certain problems. What are those? Only certain values, certain specific values of n. What are those? That are n is equal to 1, 2, 3, and so on. So these are the logical values of n, and n must always start from 1. It never starts from 0 in case of particle in a box problem. But I kindly remember this value of n that I am saying that it is starting from n is equal to 1. It is just for this problem. We have to obtain the minimum value of n in different problems according to the logic that satisfies the problem, that satisfies the system. I have just applied my logic on the system, and my system is obeying these logics. So these, for n is equal to 1, 2, 3, I will be, and so on, for positive integral values of n, I will be getting logical solutions or meaningful solutions. On the other hand, for n is equal to 0 or n is equal to negative integers, I will be getting meaningless solutions. So I would erase this now. Kn is equal to n phi, and therefore n is equal to 1, 2, 3. So this gives me k is equal to n pi upon n. This is equation 9. If I square it, I will get k square is equal to n square pi square upon n square. Now we can put the value of k square, which I have erased actually. You can see that equation. I remember its value. We assumed that k square is equal to 2m e upon h cross square. If I put this value of k square in 10, then I will get that 2m e upon h cross square will be equal to n square pi square by n square, and therefore e will be equal to n square into pi square h cross square by 2m l square. Now this quantity is a constant. Let me call it to be q. Therefore e is n square times q. Why it is constant? Pi is a constant, h cross is a constant, 2 is constant. M is mass of particle, which is constant. L is the length of box, which is also constant. So, for example, if we have electron between O and P, and L, that is the length of the box, is let us say 1 angstrom, then we can put L is equal to 10 raised to power minus 10 meter, and M can be written as 9.1 into 10 raised to power minus 31 kg. Kindly remember, we are solving Schrodinger equation. Therefore, it is given that it has to be assumed that the speed of the particle is very small as compared to speed of light, because Schrodinger equation is applicable only for non-relativistic cases. So therefore, this mass m, we will not talk about whether this is mass at rest or it is in motion, because in non-relativistic cases, the mass at rest and mass at motion both are identical with each other. So therefore, this energy E will be integral multiple of Q. Since different values of N will give me different values of E, therefore instead of using the symbol E, I would rather prefer to use a new symbol for energy as En. This index n is attached to E just to tell that E is different for different values of Q. So what will be the minimum possible energy for a particle confined to one dimensional box? It will be E1, that will be equal to 1 square Q, it is equal to Q, This is called ground state energy. Next possible value. Okay, the next value of E, that is obtained for N is equal to 2, and that is E2 is equal to 2 square Q, that is equal to 4 Q. This is called first excited state. Similarly, E3 will be equal to 9 Q. This is second excited state. E4 will be equal to 16 Q. That will be third excited state, and so on. Now, with these values of energy, we can draw the energy level diagram of particle which is trapped in a one-dimensional box of length L. What is that? The minimum energy possible of a particle in one-dimensional box is E1, that is Q. Next is E2, that is equal to 4Q. Next is E3, which is equal to 9Q. Next is E4, which is equal to 16Q, and so on. Now, the energy difference between ground level and the first excited level is 3Q. Next energy difference is 5Q. Next energy difference is 7Q. So, with the second boundary condition, we are able to see that the particle which is trapped in one dimensional box cannot have any value of any arbitrary value of energy. It can have only specific values of energies. So therefore second boundary condition gives us that energy of the particle is quantized. It is always an integral multiple of Q, where Q is equal to pi square h cross square upon 2mm square. These are universal constants. M is the mass of the particle. Let us say if it is an electron, then we can write m equal to 9.1 into 10 raised to power minus 31 kilogram. And l is the length of the box. That may be, let us say, if it is an electron trapped in a region of the order of 1 angstrom, then we can put l is equal to 10 raised to power minus 10 meter. If we put all these values here, then we can find out what is the minimum possible energy that the electron can have. What is important to note that this energy level diagram is not evenly spaced, the energy difference is not even, the energy difference is increased with as the value of n increases, the energy difference is increasing. This is in some contrast with the energy values of an electron in an atom, that is equal to minus 13.6 upon n square. Here, in case of that is in the units of electron volt, of course. In case of electron trapped in a hydrogen atom, actually the principal quantum number n, it also comes with square, but it is in the denominator. There it is in the numerator. Due to that reason, the energy difference in case of energy levels of an electron and a hydrogen atom, it decreases as the values of n increases. And here the energy levels, values of the energy levels are increasing as the value of n is increasing. What is important thing to note here is that the minimum possible energy, before that let me clarify to you that the potential energy of the particle is already zero. So therefore total energy, which is equal to kinetic energy plus potential energy, will be simply equal to kinetic energy, because potential energy u is 0. So therefore we can simply say that En, which is total energy of the particle, I have written E as En, the reason I have already given to you. So the total energy of the particle is simply the kinetic energy of the particle. Now what is the minimum total energy? It will be simply equal to minimum kinetic energy, and it is nothing but E1, which is equal to Q, and that is not equal to 0. So this is a very important observation that we obtain from this result, that whenever a particle is trapped in a box, one dimensional box of a certain length, that particle, its minimum energy is non-zero, rather its minimum kinetic energy is non-zero. The reason that kinetic energy is always non-zero means that this particle is always in motion. Either it is moving toward right or it is moving toward left. So it will never be at rest. That is the important observation that we can make. That whenever any particle is confined within certain space or a limited region of the universe, it will never be at rest. So that is an important or very beautiful consequence of the quantum mechanics. This, although we are not doing motion of electron in a hydrogen atom, we are doing particle in a box. Therefore, I cannot use these results quantitatively for calculating the, let us say, problems of hydrogen atom. However, I can qualitatively apply these conclusions to the electron in an hydrogen atom, because electron in an hydrogen atom is equivalent to particle in a box. The difference is that here the box is one dimensional, there the box is three dimensional, here the particle motion is only linear, there the particle will have linear, it will have linear as well as angular momenta. Both of these will be present whenever an electron motion inside hydrogen atom is considered. So I can very simply assume before doing any calculation, if of course I am not going to do that right now, hydrogen atoms I will not be teaching to you in this chapter, but if you study good books, particularly the book which I am mentioning again and again in my lecture, that is Powell and Kreisman book, if you go there and you study the hydrogen atom spectrum, we will just see that the conclusions drawn here are applicable qualitatively in hydrogen atom also. For example, here we have noticed that energies of particle in a box are quantized. The same conclusions can be very easily applied to electron in an atom, that energies of electron in an atom are quantized. And we already know that in lower classes we have studied, at least the formula we have the knowledge, that is minus 13.6 electron volt by n square for an hydrogen atom. Second conclusion that we have drawn here is that whenever a particle is confined in a limited region of the universe, it can never be at rest. Same thing can be applied to the electron in an atom. Since electron can never leave the atom, it is equivalent to particle in a box. So therefore, electron in atom can never be at rest. These are the two conclusions which we can simply just apply from here to the electron in an atom. In fact, this is a sort of a virtual problem that has been designed to just give curiosity to the students that what are the beautiful consequences of the quantum mechanics. We can apply this to real problems, and the first real problem that is equivalent to particle in a box is actually the electron inside an atom. So that is the beauty of this topic being studied here. Next, we will continue our discussion. Now we have noticed that we have applied both of the boundary conditions. First boundary condition gave me the value of B. Second boundary condition gave me the value of A, which was not acceptable to me. On logical grounds, I rejected it. So instead of giving the value of A, it gave me the condition of quantization of energy. So the value of A is still to be found. How do we find it? Now, for finding the value of A, we just turn our attention to the wave function. We know that the wave function of the particle sine is given by A sine kx because B is 0. But we also know that KL is equal to n pi, which means that K is equal to n pi by L. I can put this value of K here. Therefore, my wave function will become equal to A sine n pi by L and x. So, let us say this is equation number 10. Now, A is something which I do not know. To find A, I will make an assertion. What is that assertion? A is chosen in such a way that psi becomes normalized. I assume that you have also attended my previous lectures in which I have told you what is the difference between a normalized and unnormalized wave function and what is the importance of a normalized wave function. For I will not go into that detail, but I will now use that knowledge here. I will simply say, since I have assumed that A is chosen in such a way that the wave function becomes normalized, it means since now wave function is normalized, therefore psi magnitude square is exactly equal to probability density. Probability density means, kindly remember, it is a one-dimensional problem. So probability density will be equal to probability of finding the particle in small longitudinal region. So it will be simply equal to dp by dx, where dp is a small probability of finding the particle in a region whose length is dx, around a point which is at a distance x from the origin. So therefore I can write it to be dp is equal to psi magnitude square dx. Now, since we know that particle can exist only from 0 to L, therefore if I integrate dp from x equal to 0 to x is equal to L, my answer should be 1 because the particle is definitely present within these two limits. So therefore probability of finding the particle from 0 to L must be 1. Okay, now I can put the value of psi magnitude square. Now we okay, it will become psi magnitude square integration 0 to L dx is equal to 1. Now put the value of psi from equation number 10, that will become A square 0 to L, A being constant, I have therefore written it outside the integration, sine square n pi by L x dx is equal to 1. Now I would apply the expression of trigonometry, it will become A square by 2, 0 to L, 1 minus cos 2 n pi by L x dx is equal to 1. Now this integration, if I do, it will become A square by 2 x minus L upon 2 n pi sine of n pi x by L and limits from 0 to L equal to 1. If I put the limits, this will simply give me A square by 2 and L minus 0 equals to 1. That gives me A square is equal to 2 by L. That gives A is equal to 2 by L. So therefore, if I assume that, if I make this assertion that the wave function is normalized, then the value of A will be evaluated. If I put this value of A back in 10, then the complete normalized wave function is, so the normalized wave function is given by psi equal to 2 upon L square root sine of n pi by L x. So this is the final expression for the wave function. This wave function is part eigen function. So I have already told you about eigen functions, eigen operators and eigen values and eigen equations. in my previous lectures. I will advise you to please refer to that lecture. And if you do not have the knowledge of this eigen function. So next is this energy value which we have obtained, En is equal to m square q, which is also written as m square pi square h cross square upon 2ml square. This is also called energy eigen value. This is called energy eigen value. So this is the energy eigen function. This is the eigen function and this is the eigen values, energy eigen values of particle in one dimensional box. Now we may be surprised that why particle can have energies equal to q, or next it will be 4q, then 9q, then 16q, then 25q, and so on. Why the particle cannot obtain or possess the energies intermediate between these values? For example, between q and 4q there are many values, let us say 1.5q or 2q or 3q or 3.7q, etc. These energies cannot be possessed by particle in a box. After q, the next possible energy is only 4q. All other energies between these two points, these two values, are not possible. So for that I would just tell you a postulate of Bohr's theory, just to have you so that you can have enjoy this part of the article. I would just remind that with you that in case of Bohr's theory, it was one of the postulate was that the certain electron can revolve around nucleus only in certain orbits having specific energies. Those specific energies are obviously quantized energies that we have studied in plus 2 class. Then what are those specific energies? It was given by Bohr in third postulate, the postulate that I told you just earlier. It was second postulate. The third postulate said that only those orbits are permissible in which the angular momentum L is integral multiple of h upon 2 pi. In our case, it is now h cross. We know that in the lower classes, we do not introduce h cross to you. But this is the case. So, only those orbits are possible in which angular momentum is integral multiple of h upon 2 pi. Now, here, for particle in one dimensional box, the motion is only linear. So, particle cannot have angular momentum. If I assume that the universe is only one dimensional, no other point in the universe is available, and therefore only x-axis is available in the universe, in that case the particle will have only linear momentum. So, if the possibility of or the permissibility of the orbits in a three-dimensional orbit of Bohr atom is due to the quantization of angular momentum, therefore we can simply expect that the possibility of the quantization of energy levels of particle in one dimensional box must be due to quantization of linear momentum. So just as in Bohr's model, angular momentum must be integral multiple of some quanta. Kindly remember, h upon 2 pi is the quanta of angular momentum. Angular momentum less than this value is not possible in case of hydrogen atom, because minimum value of L is 1. Similarly, there must be some quanta of linear momentum of particle in one dimensional box. What is the minimum momentum that the particle can have? That is called a quanta of linear momentum. That we can very easily obtain. We know that. Now I can erase it. It was just for comparison. It's not a part of the article. Now, I hope you might have got my point. Let us now go to that. We know that K is equal to n pi by L. We know this. Now the momentum, linear momentum, is equal to h cross K. If I put the value of K, it will become h cross into n pi by L. I can put the value of h cross as h upon 2 pi, and this will be n pi by L. And pi will get cancelled. I can write n outside. It will be h upon 2L. This is P. So, let us say this is equation number 13. So I would, for reference, I am writing that equation again, which I erased actually. I thought that I will not be needing it, but now I think that I must write it. L was equal to N into H upon 2 pi. Look at the similarity. N is here, H is here, 2 is here, 2 is here. Here, this is L, length of the box. Here it is pi. So, the quanta of angular momentum in case of hydrogen atom is H upon 2 pi. And the quanta of linear momentum in case of particle in a box is H upon 2L. So therefore only those orbits are permissible in which the linear momentum of the particle in a box is integral multiple of H upon 2L. Now, I just raised from myself a problem that why these energies are not possible. The answer is here. For these, all these energies, 1.5Q, 2Q, 3Q, 3.7Q, etc. All these energies which are in the gap, what is not being satisfied is this equation. For all these energies, P is not integral multiple of H upon 2L, therefore those energies are not available. Those energy levels are not permissible levels. So, and these levels, Q, 4Q, 9Q, 16Q, 25Q, these are permissible levels, and at these values of energies, the linear momentum is quantized. So, this is an important thing that I just wanted to share with you. Next, the last part of this article is the point where I started the article. I must now finish it from that angle which I started. Initially, during the start of this article, I said to you that what should be the graph between psi and x. There was no doubt that the graph to the left of O and to the right of L should be 0. I said that I will not bet, these were my wordings at the start of this article, that I will not bet on the shape of the graph between 0 to L. However, I can bet on the shape of the graph to the left of O and to the right of P. That was the name of point, and the coordinates of that point are P point R L. Actually, I can write that also P. Here it is O, X is equal to 0, X is equal to L. So what is the shape of the graph? Now, the shape of the graph, now it is a function of value of N. Let us now come with the minimum value of N. That is N is equal to 1. Now, for N is equal to 1, we know that psi is equal to square root of 2 by L sine of n pi x by L. If I put n is equal to 1, therefore psi will become square root of 2 by L sine of pi by L and x. Now this will be the wave function for n is equal to 1. So therefore it will be the graph of a wave function versus x for ground state energy of the particle. If I put x equal to 0, then sin 0 is 0, so I will get psi equal to 0. This is actually the boundary condition which has to be satisfied in all conditions. It is nothing but the same thing. If I put x is equal to L by 2, then if I put L by 2 here, you can see that it will become pi by 2. And sin pi by 2 is 1, therefore psi will be equal to square root of 2 by L. If I put x is equal to L, then I will get sin pi here. Sin pi is again 0 and psi is equal to 0. Kindly remember this and this were the boundary conditions which I initially imposed on the system, and these has to be obviously satisfied by the final solution. So at x equal to 0, psi is equal to 0, and at x equal to L, psi is equal to 0. These conditions are initially imposed and these are now actually verified, being verified. Now what we can see that the value of wave function is maximum at x equal to L by 2, this. And let us say somewhere here, this value is 2 by L square root. So therefore, if I draw it in horizontal line here, I can very easily understand, since it is a sine graph, kindly remember this wave function is a sine function. So therefore, the graph of psi versus x for n is equal to 1 will be of this shape. Please remember that the graph to the left of O is 0 and graph to the right of P is 0. This is a trivial, therefore I will not refer it to. Now, I am more interested in the graph between psi square and x. So this point I can draw analogy. So let us say somewhere this point is 2 by L, because psi, if contains, it contains under root 2 by L, then psi square must contain 2 by L. Now if I draw the analogy, then this will be like this. Now this is called probability density graph. It extends from 0 to L. Now the point where this probability density is maximum is called antinode, and the point where the probability density is 0 is called node. So for n is equal to 1, we have seen that there is one antinode which is at L by 2, and there are two nodes which are at 0 and L. So what will happen if I choose n is equal to 2? So for n is equal to 2, I would just take this as last example. For n is equal to 3 and so on, you can just anticipate the results. For n is equal to 2, our wave function, I can put here 2, our wave function will become this. Now I will choose these points, x is equal to 0, L by 4, L by 2, 3L by 4 and L. These will be the 5 points that I will choose. If I put the psi x is equal to 0 here, you will simply see that psi will be equal to 0. If I put L by 4 here, it will be sine pi by 2, it will be under root 2 by L, it will be 0 here, it will be minus under root 2 by L, and it will be 0 here again. So we can very easily verify that the graph, let us say this is minus 2 by L square root somewhere here. So graph is going to be, let us say this is L by 4, this is 3L by 4. So the graph is going to be like this. It is a sine graph and it will be one complete cycle. Now if I draw the graph of psi square, then the graph of psi square will be like this. So now this is for n is equal to 2. We see that there are two antinodes. One is at L by 4, this is L by 4, and another is at 3L by 4. So antinodes are the points where the probability of finding the particle is maximum. So at n is equal to 1, particle had maximum chances of being found at the middle of the box. On the other hand, at n is equal to 2, particle has maximum chances of being found at L by 4 and 3L by 4. It has zero probability of being found at the middle of the box where it was maximum for n is equal to 1. So kindly remember, for n is equal to 2, I have two antinodes and three nodes. One is at 0, another is at L by 2, and another is at L. In general, for a given value of n, there will be n antinodes and there will be n plus 1 nodes that you must remember. So this graph is very important. In quantum mechanics, in your lower classes, you might have seen this kind of graph for S, this kind of graph for Px, this kind of graph for Py, and this kind of graph for Pz. This is outside the board actually. Sorry for bad line. Outside the board. So, what are these kinds of probability density graphs which you have already studied in your plus 2 class? These are nothing but actually psi magnitude sphere graphs for the electron density of electron in an atom. So, these are actually four dimensional on the computer. These can be plotted or not possible on the, let us say, board. But these shapes you can anticipate. Similarly, these are the shapes of the orbitals. These are the shapes of the energy levels. In case of particle in a box, we cannot talk about this term as orbits or orbitals. Since motion is only one dimensional, we can just talk about energy shells, energy levels or energy states. Okay, so I think you might have enjoyed my lecture today. So I will stop here now, and in the next lecture I will discuss more with related to the Schrodinger equation with you people, and I will also introduce to you uncertainty principle and some of its consequences. Till then I will stop here, and it's goodbye to you. Thank you. Thanks.